I'm living for right now. Cause what if tomorrow never comes? I'm not waiting, I'm not waiting for the confetti to fall.
Welcome to my channel, and in today's video I'm going to be talking about three myths about the Christian walk. And if you see me looking down, I'm looking at my notes, and let's get right into it. So the first myth is that you can be saved through your parents or through a loved one. Now let's just talk about the word saved. So when I say saved, I mean you're saved from hell. You're going to heaven, and hell is, you're not going to be separated from God. So in the world, we live in a world where you can get things and you can get things accomplished and things done by the people that you know. But it doesn't work that way in the heavenly realm. I want to talk about another scripture that talks about salvation. So I'm going to go to Acts 16 verses 30 and 31. So the book that I'm reading from is Tony Evans' Study Bible, and this is life-changing. I love this Study Bible. Okay, let me tell you what's happening here, because if I just read it, it might be confusing. So basically, in this chapter, Paul and Silas, they're in prison, and they're in prison because they commanded a spirit to come out of a fortune teller. So right now they're in prison and they're praying and they're singing, and then an earthquake happens and the doors were opened, and the guard, you know, the person who's like watching them, is like, oh no, the door's open. Like, what am I going to do? And at that moment, actually he was about to kill himself because he thought they were going to escape. And he was like, well, if they escape, then my life is over. So let me just do it. And Paul stops him and he says, wait, don't do anything. Like, we're still here. Like, there's no need to take your life. So then the jailer, he, started to believe in the power of their God, which, you know, is God. He didn't know this at the time. And he actually asked, in verse 30, what must I do to be saved? And they responded and they said, believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved, you and your household. Now, I want to explain this, because this is kind of like the opposite of what I'm saying, that you can't have salvation through someone else. So, so let me give you an example. So, my family, we're really big on crabbing. Now, if you don't know what crabbing is, it's just like fishing, but instead of catching fish, you catch crabs. And, what we do, we have like baskets, and there's some baskets that's kind of just like open, but then there's some baskets that close. And we put some chicken backs in, we tie them in, you know, crabs like chicken backs. And we don't go on a boat, it's a bridge, and we kind of like tie it onto the bridge, and we like put it down in the water, let it sit for a little bit, and then we pull it up, and that's how we catch crabs. This is something that we've been doing for generations, and this is something that I do enjoy.
When I get older,
I am going to take my family out to go crabbing. We're going to have barbecues and buy snacks and have our lounge chairs. Like, we're going to do the thing. And I know, like, just stay with me. I know it's kind of off topic. But on the contrary, my brother, he's not really that into crabbing. First, he's not really, like, into, like, the let me wake up early and go out and get my hands dirty. Like, I don't think he'd probably rather go to the store. But number second, which is the most important, he's like allergic to shellfish. So he's not going to take his family out and, you know, like, that's not going to be something that, like, that he initiates and that he would want to do. And after a while, he kind of just stopped going, like, yeah, I don't really care for it, because he doesn't eat crabs. Now, if you, like, take that situation and kind of apply that to salvation, like, just because somebody grew up in the church and just because, like, they've done something with their family, that doesn't mean that that's going to be a part of their life and that their heart is really in it. What's important is that you're serious about God. Like, you and I, like, we're serious about God, and that we let him into our hearts and we let him change our attitudes. And so even though the scripture is saying, like, you know, you and your household, but that doesn't mean that they're automatically going to be saved. The probability is higher because you train, you know, the children in a way that they should go, so that when they're older, they won't depart from it. But that doesn't automatically mean, oh, I'm saved, I can do whatever I want and not worry about my heart, not worry about inviting God into my life. I also want to look at Romans 10:9. And, you know, when you do read scripture, one thing that I like to do is I like to compare scriptures with scriptures. So I'm not just looking at like one scripture, Just like if you're studying something, you're not going to look at one article or just one book. Like, you're going to get a bunch of different resources and you're going to kind of bring it all together and compare it. And that's the same thing that we, you know, should do with the Bible, so that we can get the best or the most information. So Romans 10:9, it says, if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. And that's the thing. You have to, it says confess with your mouth and also believe in your heart. And it's your mouth, it's your heart. Nobody else can do that for you. So salvation is something that is personal. And I just don't want, you know, I don't want people to kind of get that confused and think like, oh, my parents are pastors, like I'm good. But like, no, it has to be personal. All right, so now let's move into the second myth, which is probably the biggest one, the biggest lie, and the one that I struggle with the most, is that you need to clean yourself up first, then come to God. Now, this is a huge lie from the enemy, because he does this purposefully so that you will not come to him. And this is one of my main struggles. And, you know, this struggle is for everyone. It's not just for, like, you know, people who have not received the Lord, or, you know, they feel like they're like too messed up, or they've done bad things and they don't feel worth it. And it's also for the person who is a believer and has been believing for a year, 5 years, 10 years, 20, 30, 50. And sometimes you just feel like there's areas of your life where you can't invite God into. It's a lie. And I've experienced both sides. And I remember this one time I had spent the summer being out of fellowship with the Lord, and I was angry at him and I was upset with him because I didn't get the promotion that I wanted. And guess what? In the end of the summer, I ended up getting the promotion anyway, and I felt so dumb and I felt so stupid. But like, you know, I was praying about it and everything. Like, I'm like, I know, Lord, like this comes from you. Like, I'm trusting you. And when it didn't happen right away, it didn't happen the way that I thought that it would happen. And it was like a bummer to me. But then I spent that whole summer out of fellowship being angry at the Lord, thinking that I couldn't talk to him. And it was just like that summer. I remember that summer. That was not a good summer. It just was not a good summer. And, you know, I just don't want you to make that same mistake. And just think about if you have a loved one, if they're upset with you, would you want them to stop talking to you for months until they're completely over it? Or would you want them to come to you and kind of like vent it out, and so you guys can work it out? That's the same way that the Lord is with us. Like, he loves us. He doesn't care like what mess we have. Like, the Bible says that we come to me, all who are burdened and heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Like, he wants you to come to him. He doesn't want you to try to clean yourself up and then come to him, because A, it's impossible. You can't do it. I tried and I failed, but I've had more success, more progress when I came to him with all of my mess. Jeremiah 31:25. It says, for I satisfy the thirsty person and feed all those who are weak. The one thing that I love about the Lord is that he doesn't think like us. So, you know, we think like, oh, if you're strong-minded, healthy emotionally, you can go to God because he's not going to be ashamed of you, or whatever example your mind is telling you or the enemy tells you. But here it says that, you know, he satisfies those who are weak. His strength is made perfect in your weakness. That's scripture too. And that's the thing. Like, people think like, oh, I'm not good enough to go to God. But the fact that you are not good enough makes it more likely that you will go to him, because you need to depend on him. And that's what he wants. He wants you to depend on him, because he's the creator of the universe. Like, he can handle anything you have to throw at him. He's not like us. If you come to me and if you're angry or whatever, and you all yelling at me, I'm gonna yell at you back. But God is not gonna do that. God is love. Like, he can handle your anger. He can handle your pain. He can handle your hurt. And I think sometimes we feel like he can't, or like we're not good enough to go to him, or we're not ready to go to him. But that is a lie from the enemy. And I I encourage you just to go to him as you are. It does not matter. Like, you can be doing anything with anyone. Like, it does not matter. Just go to him. One thing. Ooh, here's something I actually like to remember when I'm having these thoughts of like, oh, I'm not good enough. Like, let me clean up this area first and then bring it to him. You can't take clean clothes to the cleaners. And number three, the last myth that I want to talk about is that Christians are like perfect and they have it all together. And I mean, this can be a thought from unbelievers and can be a thought from believers. This is a huge myth. And I'm going to go in here and say that there is no difference between me and you. There's no difference between me and a prostitute. The only difference is that I allow God inside of my heart. That's it. Now, you know, when God is in my heart, he does change me. He changed my desires. He changed, you know, the things that I want to do and the things that I watch and the things that I say. And he does that, but it doesn't have anything to do with me. And the main word that I kind of want to focus on is sanctification. So people, or some people might think like, oh, once you're saved, you know, you kind of just got to drop everything and just live this, you know, miraculously changed life. And it doesn't work like that. Sanctification is the process of, you know, the Lord cleaning out your heart and cleaning out your life and cleaning out your mind. And this can take, I mean, for some people, like, you know, I know very few, but, you know, some people who they were saved and they just kind of just didn't look back. They were just like, okay, well, I'll just drop this stuff and I'm going to, you know, read my word and study and develop a prayer life and go to church. And for some people, it's easy for them. But for most people, it's not. And it takes years. And for me, it took years. Like, when I got serious about, like, you know, the Lord coming into my life when I was in college, it still took another 2 to 3 years for me to stop drinking and fornicating. Like, it didn't just happen like that. But what I noticed is that it would kind of get spaced out. So if, you know, maybe I was going out every week, then maybe it'll move to every 2 weeks, then maybe it moves to every month, then like 3 or 4 months, and, you know, then years. And I wish I could tell you that, you know, since college I haven't had any slip-ups, but, well, I'm not even gonna say I wish I can tell you, because the reality is it's just not true. And it's like, life is hard and you're gonna make mistakes and you're gonna mess up. And the important thing is that you repent, which doesn't mean just saying sorry, but you're turning away from that sin and you're not going back. But the reality is sometimes you mess up and you go back. But that's part of the sanctification process. Like, you're gonna make mistakes, you're going to mess up. And the important thing is that you don't do number two. That was funny. I'm at number two on my list, and you don't try to say like, oh, let me clean myself up first and then come back to you. The important thing is you just let him back in as soon as you can. And that's basically all that I wanted to mention. And if you have any questions, if you have any comments, let me know. You know, you can share your experiences in the comments. Don't forget to like, don't forget to subscribe, and know that I am here for you. Bye. I already paid for it. Got your life in my hands. No, my love now.